So let me introduce our first speaker, which is Andrés Sarangin, who is professor of archaeology at the Federal University of Minas Gerais in Brazil, Universidade Federal de Minas Gerais. He is also a researcher at CONICET, senior representative for Southern America at the World Archaeological Congress, and head of the Brazilian Antarctic Human Science Project. His current research interests include archaeology of architecture, archaeological theory, and Antarctic archaeology. He has published a number of books and is editor of Vestigios, Revista Latinoamericana de Arqueología Histórica. So, please, Andrés, this is your time, the floor is yours.
Thank you, Javier, for the presentation. First of all, I would like to thank the organizer of this workshop for the invitation, Christian and Jim. We have a very good time discussing several of the points, issues I'm going to talk about. Also, I would like to apologize because I have changed the title of the presentation, and that's because with Melissa Salerno in the last 2 weeks we have discussed and changed some things that we think are more relevant for the discussion in here. Since 1995, I'm the head of a research project that seeks to learn more about human presence in Antarctica, in particular, but not exclusively, about human encounters with the South Shetland Islands in the 19th century. In 2015, Melissa Salerno and I wrote an article discussing the particularities of the Anthropocene in the southern continent. The presentation will take up some of the ideas considered there and will add some others. Reflections emerge from a critical review or own work. They consider some of the constraints we found when we limit ourselves to applying traditional models and methods to define the range of human interaction with the material world. And other possibilities we are currently exploring are a broader definition of material world, a bodily experience, and the interconnectedness of the webs of life. These impressions are not finished. They are just a moment in a constant flow of ideas, perceptions, and emotions. Some time ago, we were invited by Matt Edwardshaw to contribute an article for a special issue of the Anthropocene. We were asked to think about Antarctica. The notion of Anthropocene opened up possibilities to discuss the between nature and culture, two concepts that seem to be pervasive among scholars dealing with the southern continent. As a first move, we decided to gather information on how human presence in Antarctica was defined by scholars studying the Anthropocene on a global scale. We found some interesting statements. In 1989, McCloskey and Spalding held that Antarctica was part of a territory still being mostly shaped by the force of nature. In Putting People in the Map of 2008, Ellis and Ramancucci separate Antarctica from other biomes that define as anthropogenic. Even though some study understand human action as responsible for causing the reduction of ice sheets, the decline of animal colonies, among others, much of the literature provides an image of Antarctica as a territory on the fringe of what was usually called the Anthropocene. Antarctica was associated with nature and wilderness, a reality which was considered almost opposite to culture. This representation helped essentialize the continent, transforming it into a relic of an era when our species had not yet reached all the corners of the world. As archaeologists, it was obvious to us that the parameters that some scholars used to measure the Anthropocene include compelling and overwhelming material expression, such as buildings, roads, etc. We were absent, of course, in Antarctica. The importance of nature in the face of culture and the opposition between this term was clear when we considered the discipline operated in Antarctica. While research projects in natural science were dominant, those in humanities and social science represent a minority. The lack of communication between these fields only increased the gap. The start of our own research project narrowed the situation in the 1990s. A group of Argentinian geologists working in Livingston Island formed a series of old artifacts in a cave. This is the South Shetland Islands, close to the Antarctic Peninsula. And here is the Livingston Island in yellow, Banks Peninsula. And these are images of the cave where the geologists found the archaeological remains. They decided to call us because, of course, it was cultural material. Even though some people say their remains were part of a shelter improvised by Caswell, I found out that they were part of a larger group of camps established by sealers. Between the early 19th and the early 20th century, the South Shetland Islands were the primary focus of for sealing industry in Antarctica. Captains distributed small groups, gangs of workers on the shores. At the end of the season, a single vessel could load thousands of sealskins and tons of oil. The road was not easy. Sealers' camps were not impressive for general public. The authorities of the Argentinian Antarctic Institute in 2001 told us, "Why do you want to make archaeology in Antarctica? There are no pyramids there." Understanding the monumentality of pyramids as the material expression with which is worth studying. And I swear it was not me, but 2 years ago there was some information in journals, in TV, saying that archaeologists has found pyramids in Antarctica. Of course, this was a fake information. In spite of this, as time went by, we managed to create an international project of historical archaeology in Antarctica, including researchers from Brazil, Argentina, Chile, and some other countries. And what we did, of course, what was to search for what we were once taught to find: artifacts, structures, and ecofacts, whose distribution and abundance define archaeological sites. These are the archaeological map of South Shetland. The points in red are the archaeological site we already have found. Human interaction with the world were supposed to take solid, concrete, finished forms. Without this trace, we were lost. Only by the peninsula, fieldwork made it possible to detect 27 archaeological sites corresponding to 19th century sealer camps. We decided to focus attention on them, Historical documents gave little information on sealers' life in southern continent, but archaeological evidence seemed to be enlightened. At first, consideration of artifacts, structures, and ecofacts gave us a chance to consider certain practices. If we learn that sealers built their shelters using local materials, that they usually ate the same animals they killed for market, that they had to do their best to keep on using their old clothes and shoes, that they spend their leisure hours playing board games or smoking tobacco or drinking alcohol, among others. As we will show later, we did not pay too much attention to some other issues. In short, we felt we did not have enough evidence to study them. Field would detect very few traces of human presence in the 20th and 21st centuries. Leaving aside different areas of the shore, showing remains brought by the currents, by the sea current, we only identified a few isolated artifacts connected with scientific activities. In the 1959, the Antarctic Treaty prohibited the development of military exercise in the continent and set a limit to the economic exploitation of resources. Antarctica was transformed into an international territory connected to scientific and cooperation research. In the 1990s, the Madrid Protocol set specific principles that regulate human activity. These standards urge scientists to remove every single item they had brought with them. These are some pictures of our camps. We live in camps, and when we leave Antarctica, we have to take with us everything. I mean, everything. That means only your rejected, yeah? Your shit and that kind of things. Okay, the intention was that visitors could act as spectators of nature, reducing human disturbance everything they could. Considering our previous work, we understand that the distinctive features of Antarctica did not rest on its wilderness or in its return to a certain state of wilderness, considering that human history of the continent could have started differently. From our standpoint, the distinctive features of Antarctica were nothing but a product of the historical ways in which humans interact with the material world. Over the course of time, people moved from uncontrolled exploitation of animal resources to scientific research and the persistent concern for environmental conservation. In the 19th century, sealer left humble but visible material traces of their presence. In the 20th and 21st centuries, scientists made an effort to delete or reduce their own. As archaeologists, we captured that this circumstance should not be confused with the absence of human interaction with Antarctica. On the contrary, the Anthropocene intensified in Antarctica, taking particular forms. As it was frequently used, at least for referring to the case of Antarctica, the notion of Anthropocene seems to equate the history of human interaction with the environment with increasing physical impact on the latter. And the apparent lack or the decrease in the abundance of this trace with nature were part of this process. We argue that excluding other variables from the analysis end up creating a generalizing model which masks the multiple relationship that humans establish with the world. But if the scholars have their own fixed categories to measure the Anthropocene, we also have our own. Theirs seems to be more impressive material expressions, while ours include small findings. Anyway, our own categories left a whole series of things aside. Was that it? Rethinking material relation with Antarctica? Did we need to limit the study of human interaction with Antarctica to the analysis of artifacts, structures, or ecofacts? What about animals, sea, ice, wind, shores, cliff, cyanide, people bodies, among others? Were not they material? Were they too natural? Tillich's experience in Antarctica, as well as our own, pointed the multiple relationship with the material world that were impossible to grasp through the orthodox categories of archaeology. A couple of years ago, we started exploring, mainly from a phenomenological standpoint, the possibility of considering the material dimension of the body, the emotional, the synesthetic, and kinesthetic experience of the world, the dimension of the sensible and the sentient, the interconnectedness of the flesh. We believe that some of these ideas will be helpful to rethink the dynamic of the Anthropocene in Antarctica. It is a web of life with all of its flush a long time. Sealers. At some point, we had the impression that when we only study artifacts and structures from sealers' camps, we had forgotten we were dealing with sealers. As the historian Stackpole in 1950 says of the sealing industry, sealers were a mix of sailors and hunters. Because behind these simple words, a complex net mesh of humans and non-human entities began to emerge. Water, air, vessels, people, animals were all part of a more dynamic and moving universe. We will just consider some elements. As this mesh is obviously larger, far more comprehensive and complex. For years, we did not go farther than the South Shetlands. Even though we accept the sealers only spent the summer season there, and the sealing was a world industry, we remained only on the islands. Sites were the primary unit of analysis. We were simple fix. The sedentaries of our own archaeological project did not lead us to consider sealers moving. However, sealers spent most of their voyage on board of the vessels on moving entity that took them from one corner of the world to another. Water, air were the elements, but water and air were not something that we were used to this approach. Nevertheless, they exist. They had a fluid materiality, and they were important to sealers as to sailors. When a man entered the trade, he had to get his sea legs. He had to overcome seasickness, a result of the misbalance between the movement of his body and the vessel. He also had to learn how to sail the ship. Opening and closing the sails was necessary to get the most of the wind, but also to protect the vessel from the storm and gale. A man also had to learn how to synchronize his movement with the movement of the rest of the crew. Sailing created an orchestrated dance of bodies and things. The vessel was an animated entity which not always responds to people's will. Sealers had to sail the South Shetland when the sea was free from the ice sheet. They had to approach the coast with the practical knowledge of a sailor, considering the entrance and the re-entrance of the sea, the place where it was safe to drop anchor. Until recently, we did not consider the relationship between sea, air, vessels, and sealers. But we are currently working with maritime and underwater archaeologists interested in the subject and considering future work with oceanographers and climatologists. It is also surprising that we have approached sealers for years, but we have paid little attention to hunting itself. When we studied sealers' camps, we found little evidence about hunting. We found scarce hunting tools, including a seal club, a knife, and some stakes. Hunting activities were supposed to take place near the shore, where the sea delays most of its trails. Animals were only considered when we referred to eating. But how people relate to animals beyond that was not even considered a possible question. However, the animals were there. Sealers did not only look for good anchorage points, but also for animal colonies. When sealers first arrived on South Shetland, the animals were not used to human presence, and they were not afraid of them. It was easy to kill them, but as time went by, it changed their habits. Some colonies we were heavily affected changed their location. Animals settled in other spots, more difficult to reach. Killing seals requires to learn their habits. Sealers have to approach them in silence, in a sort of row to prevent their escape. They use clubs in some case, and in some case firearms. The slaughter made quite an impression on those who enter the trail, transforming the fat and the skin of the animal in oil and force were a task not simple. Sealers had to learn how to handle the knife, separate the skin and the fat from the rest of the body. Trail kettles were light in small structures near the shelters. Fat was melted, the smoke was acid, choking, and it stained everything around. The oil was later stored in cask. It would light the house of different regions of the world. Meanwhile, the skin were salt or dried in the sun. If they were not affected by moisture, they would be used to produce hats and cloth in distant places. Archaeologists. But this experience was just a moment in a flux of time, space, and materials, defining the Anthropocene in Antarctica. For years, we did not take into account our own experience on South Shetland Islands. It was only part of our anecdotes of a series of marginal notes in fieldwork diaries. However, as time went by, we realized our own experience was important for understanding how scientists relate with Antarctica, how archaeologists approach the material world. Therefore, we considered it was necessary to include ourselves in this net mesh. One of the things we have learned during fieldwork was the particular experience of being in a place like Antarctica. For some of us, the journey to the South Shetland represents a rite of passage. It often takes between 10 and 15 days to arrive to the base camp, and the journey includes the use of military aircraft, boats, ships, and helicopters. In some way, we were isolated from the universe we know. We need to learn how to move in the fog, how to walk on the ice, how to sleep and organize our time in a place where the sun never sets. We need to reinforce our relation with animals, with strong winds, with snow, with the sea. Working in South Shetland is not easy. We face situations that most of archaeologists do not even imagine. We often arrive to an archaeological site and find a couple of sea elephants resting inside our archaeological site. Or other time, we have dozens of penguins observing us when we dig. We have a boat, and one day the boat disappears, and we find even like 1 kilometer away from our camp, using as a mattress by the sea elephants. Talking about those are not the archaeologists, are the penguins. So those are part of this unique experience in Antarctica. Also, we have to learn how to excavate the permafrost, frozen floor, and how to collect remains. We also have to learn how material change from here. See, got some more pictures of us with this special glove, where you can differentiate gender or even who person is. Maybe sometimes for the colors. We also have to learn how materials change from the moment we found them in the ground, how to change when we move to the ship, and in the laboratory when we work with them, and the process of conservation. Materials change their color, their size, their texture, and the shapes. After 20 years, we can say that we have gained the bodily experience of being in Antarctica, living in base camp and excavator sealer shelters. This is something more than static picture. We can feel it in the flesh. We have learned to follow the materials. We have led our body to guide us. We have come across practical meaning that help us establish a particular relation with the world we study. We need to keep on exploring the multiple relations that define the Anthropocene in Antarctica. Our orthodox education made us miss a richer and more complex universe. Archaeology has been traditionally trapped in a narrow perspective, focused in artifacts, rigid divisions of the world, oculocentries, and understandings. A net mesh perspective is interesting to overcome these limitations, to call back other materials and entities frequently excluded from archaeological interest. It's if we let them guide us, following their flows and the movements, maybe we can gain a better understanding of the life process where humans and non-human grow, interact, mix, and transform. For finish, I'm going to show. This is a movie from 1995, Smoke, Cigarros, I think, in Spanish. It was a well-known movie. And one of the characters of this movie is Angie Wren, represented by Harry Keitel, that has, is the owner of a shop, of cigarettes, of course. And during 10 years, every day, he took a picture of in the same direction, in the front of his place. Even it could look that all the time on the same picture. No, they are different. Every day the picture is different. So we made the same experience in Antarctica. And I think this is a metaphor that will show how light, sun, the air, the water, and the ice change the landscape. Thank you.
So we have a few minutes to make some questions or comments on Andres. We can see the little bit here in the front.
John Byron described of how the Kawesca hunt seals, like by walking against the wind, so that the seals won't smell the hunters. And so, yeah.
Yeah, as.
Well, I think it's still an echo. I can answer without the microphone. Hello. As I said before, at the beginning, the animals felt no. There were no problem to hunt them because they have no notion about humans. It's the same. I remember, like 15 years ago, I found an imperial penguin in the South Shetland. And you can, you know, touch it because you are not a danger for them. And in the case of the animals, they have some kind of memory, a genetic memory, I don't know. And still, they are afraid of humans. Every time less, because as I showed you, or sometimes we were digging, and penguins, for example, you have like 100 penguins around you looking, and also the sea elephants. But of course, in the case of the sealers, they have to know the animals that, of course, that will help them to hunt it in a better way. Also, you have to consider that at the beginning, in 1820, every ship returned with 15,000-20,000 skinned. And in 1825, they returned with 5-10 skinned. I mean, they killed 90% of the fauna in Antarctica. It's not small numbers, on the contrary.
Another question or comment? We will have a final discussion at the end of the session, so Andres can come back to this table. Yeah. So thank you very much again, Andres, and let's go to the next speaker.